الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفر ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله السلام عليكم This is Abu Tawba calling from Seminole County Jail Alhamdulillah, this week I would like to talk to the people about what the problem is with Islam. You know, we have to start at the very beginning to understand why we as Muslims globally are having so much difficulties with the rest of the world. There has to be some particular reasons for these things, and there are. And if we recognize what they are, I think it would help us understand what our role is and our decisions have to be. First of all, the number one thing that we have to understand is that Islam does not mean peace. As people erroneously translate, you know, I don't know how long now, but Westerners constantly say Islam means peace. Islam does not mean peace. Islam means submission, to surrender, to give up. This is the basic thing, and I know people say, well, we know this is being redundant, but we really don't understand it as the concept should be. It means to give up, just like a criminal who does a crime and the police come and they say, Aslam, give up, put your hands up and surrender. And when you surrender yourself, then you do whatever you're the one who has control of you has ordered you to do. Okay? Now, Allah is teaching us through this concept of Islam that we will find peace, that we will get peace and tranquility and enjoyment in our lives only when we surrender our wills and our desire to do that which Allah has ordered. And if we do anything other than that, if we don't surrender, if we follow our own desires in opposition to what Allah has ordered us to do, then we will not find that peace. And so Islam is in total opposition to kufr, to disbelief. Okay? Our submitting is different from kufr because kufr is demanding that you follow the immediacy of your senses, your desires, okay? And Islam is saying, no, do it the way Allah wants you to do it. So, the problem that we're going to have with Islam and kufr is that Islam is pervasive just like kufr is pervasive, meaning that it enters into every aspect, every nook and cranny of your life. It's like pouring water in a bag. It's not going to stay on the top. And it's not going to stay on the bottom. It's going to move and go through every piece of that bag. If you've got papers and books or whatever you have in that thing, they're all going to get wet. Likewise, with Islam, as you go to practice it, it's going to enter into every nook and cranny of your life if you allow it. Now, that's the problem, because you can't practice Islam and practice kufr at the same time without running into a conflict of interest, a conflict of application. The fundamental thing in Islam is aqidah. We say this word over and over again, aqidah. But what do we understand about aqidah? Aqidah, it literally is our worldview. Now, I know people say, well, that's wrong. It's our belief system, our creed. No, but what is your belief system? What is your creed? It's your view of the world. It's what you see as real. That's what it is. You know, where is Allah? Who is Allah? What His rights are upon us? What we're obliged to do? What is our reality? That's our worldview. That's our aqidah. And so the fundamental point for our aqidah is that Allah is in charge and no other ideology, no other thing has the right to tell us what to do, but Allah has the right to tell us what to do and we are obliged to follow. Now, this goes against kufr. Kufr is telling us that we have our own right, democracy, do what you like, as long as we agree. So there's a conflict of interest here, so there cannot be an acceptance of one except the rejection of the other. Because what works for the people may not be what Allah has commanded and ordained for the order and the easy running of society. And some people say, well, we have the right to do what we want to do down here. No, you don't. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that the only reason we've been created is so we can worship Him. And our worship is not just through praying, not just through fasting, not just through making hajj or giving charity. But our worship is even through sleeping, by sleeping on our side, our right side, our back, our backs if we have to, using the toilet, by sitting down and using water, even acts of worship. So it's not just something that we just do in the church, whereas we find that Crawford says, no, your religion is something that's your personal choice. You do that somewhere else, but your life practices have to be ordered by us. We tell you how and what and when and why. Okay? And so there is the pervasive opposition right there. Whereas Islam will not accept that. Kufa will accept that you say that you're a Muslim and that you follow your particular religion, but that your statement does not come into actual practice. But in practice, you are a kafir. And this is what Kufa demands of you. This is why America is such a great country, because it allows everyone from a verbal perspective to say anything they want to. You can say you're Muslim, you can say you're Jew, you can say you're Christian. Cool, you can say you're Buddhist, or whatever you want to say you want. But as a practice, you will be a kafir. You will practice the kufr way of life eventually. Why? Because I said earlier, kufr is just as pervasive as Islam. If I ask you what your aqidah is, you say you believe in Allah. Your worldview is that you believe the world is the way Allah has set it up. But if I ask you what today's date is, that's the pinnacle point of your reality, you'll probably tell me it's October or November or January or one of those make-believe months that the kuffar have invented. But if I say, no, it's Muharram or Jumad al-Ula or Rabi al-Thani, you say, no, I want the real date. What's the real date? And so that's your reality. Your reality is not Islam. Your reality is kuffar. You don't say, well, no, it's the covenant. No, but I want to be real, brother. What? No, well, then be real. Well, we can do this and do that. You can do whatever you want, but is that what you've been ordered to do? So eventually, Islam makes you make a decision, and this is the threat Islam has on the Western society. It makes you decide whether you're going to keep your statement as only a verbalization of something, or is your statement going to move to reality? Is it going to move to application? And in applying that, they want you to say, to make you afraid to apply your deen by saying if you try to apply it, you're an extremist. If you try to practice your religion in opposition to what kufr demands or says is right and wrong, and so now listen to what I'm saying. If you practice Islam in opposition to what kufr says is right and wrong, you're an extremist. So now disbelievers are determining for the believers what should and should not be practiced. And then the believers are listening to that. So they are not following what Allah has said. In practice, they're following what the kuffar has allowed them to do or said they can do. And anything else, they've been told that this is wrong. You've now gone to an extreme. Are they your shuyukh? Are these your scholars? No, they should not be. They should not be your teachers. But they seem to be. And so there has to come a point in the Muslims in the West where they make a determination of what is their reality. What is our reality? Are we Muslims trying to practice Islam? And now if they tell you, say, hey, look, this guy's telling you to be an extremist. He's telling you to go fight jihad. No, I'm not telling you to go fight jihad someplace. I'm not telling you to blow anything up or anything like that. Islam does not attack physically. Islam attacks the senses. Islam attacks the heart. It makes the individual struggle and make jihad against his own self, his own ego, and his own desire to do things in opposition to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered him to do. It's only the Westerners who make you think or would want you to think that Islam is some violent religion. Islam is not a religion. It's a way of life. And that's the distinction that we seem to lose a lot of time. Our religion is the same religion as the Christians and the Jews, the religion of Ibrahim. Period. In practice, we follow the pristine, unadulterated practices that the Prophet Ibrahim left for us to follow. That's the same thing that the Jews and the Christians claim to do. The only difference is that they have become, you know, set-tripping. They have started to just become very racist about their practices. They'll say, we're following Moses, and we refuse to follow anyone after Moses. And the Christians say, hey, we're following Jesus, and we refuse to follow anyone after Jesus. Whereas the Muslims, we don't say that. Those who were following Moses when Jesus came, they moved on to Jesus. They didn't reject Moses. They moved on to Jesus because it was now Jesus' time. And those of us who were following Jesus, well, alhamdulillah, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, we moved on to follow the Prophet Muhammad, and we didn't reject Jesus. We know the time for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has come, and with recognizing his prophethood, we recognize that his right and his our obligation to follow his leadership and his ability to detail for us in our lives the actual practices of our acts of worship and the interaction that we have in the non-worship things like marriage and business practices like that. That's all that is. And if you actually look at us, we know that we are actually, you know, if you follow the life of Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam, you'll find that he was probably looking exactly like what we see a Muslim looking and acting like today, with the beard, saying assalamu alaikum, falling on his face and praying. The same thing could be said about his mother, Maryam. When you see her in hijab, just like you see the Muslim lady, just like that. And one of the Latino brothers here, he said to me about Maryam, and I mentioned to him, well, she looks like a Muslim to me. And he thought about that. He said, oh, I don't know. I said, yeah, think about it. Look at the little thing you got on your wrist.
1 minute remaining.
And she looks like Maryam. The point I'm trying to make here, brothers and sisters, is that we have to accept Islam as a practice, as a way of life, and not as just something to be done on Yom Jumu'ah. It has to pervade every aspect of our lives. And so the question is, to everyone here, is will you accept Islam practically? Will you accept that as a way of life and look at it in a way how to apply that really in your life? أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.